Good morning.
Good morning.
That's pretty sad. Let's try again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, there we go. We get to start off today by doing an ordination. So that's why I'm up here first and not the beautiful Sean. And because she's part of the good thing that we get to start. And I had to stall a little bit because what we're going to do is we're going to ordain Jeff Stevens right here. And I had to wait because he was deaconing. He was over here helping. Jeff, I want you to come right now. And I want you to sit down on that chair right there, if you will. And Sean, if you'll stand up next to him, stand by your man. I wish we had time for the song, but we don't. Look at him give instructions. Get on the other side. That's his good side. A long time ago, like 2-3 years ago, we saw a lot in Jeff that said that that he ought to be a deacon. And so since he had never been ordained, we had this thing called DITS, Deacon in Training. And so he's been a DIT for the longest time. And it was time for us to undid him. I mean, it was just crazy that for that amount of time, but it was like he became a deacon, and soon after he became a deacon, we had COVID and so many other things, but that never stopped Jeff. Matter of fact, Jeff has been a wonderful testimony of what a deacon is supposed to be, like straight out of 1 Timothy chapter 3. He meets all the qualifications. He's trustworthy. That's one of the things that it says. He oversees tasks. As a matter of fact, he took on our security, and we've never been so secure. He has taken it so seriously, and I even have hand signals that I don't know what they are. So he's instructed me a number of times, if we look like there's an incident, I'm supposed to do, I think, this, but it might be that. But if we ever have trouble, I don't know. I don't know what I'll be doing. I'll just. He takes care of Dottie. He's that kind of guy. He's self-controlled. He's just a wonderful person. Those of you that know Jeff know this to be true. And one of the great services he gives to us and all the other deacons, he's young and strong, and none of the rest of them are. As you'll see, I'd like for all the deacons to come down and gather around Sean and Jeff right now. See, he's our only young legs on the staff. So he's just, it's wonderful to have them as a family. And when we ordain a deacon, what it is that happens is the men come around, both the man and the woman, and as they do, they lay hands on them and they pray over them and they welcome them in a very formal way into the office of being a deacon. And so just for a few minutes, that's what's going to happen. The men are going to pray, and then upon the end of that, Stan, who is the chairman of our deacons, will then pray at the end, and that will conclude this part of the service. But what is it you should do as you sit there and observe this ordination? You should pray for this family. You should pray for this man. Pray for Sean. He wants to do the right thing, the good thing. And being a deacon for him is very serious, and he's taken it with a very strong heart. And when you do anything for God, what happens is the devil knows you're off the bench. So you pray for them. Pray for them as a couple. And you pray a prayer of thanksgiving, a prayer of love over them. So I'd like for us to begin the ordination. Men, if you would all kind of surround them and put your hands on Jeff. And you begin to pray for this man.
Dear Heavenly Father, you have ordained that the stars follow your course, that the seasons follow your plan, that the oceans and tides obey your rhythms. And now you have ordained us in this service as deacons. Make us instruments of your holy will. Rinse away the useless clay and leave behind new creations. Polish your will, shaped by your fingers, dried in the warmth of your gaze, in the boldness, mercy, love with which you have found us. Guide us in your spirit so that we might complete the work that you have begun. Let us always remember that we have been ordained to serve and not to be served, to build up and not to tear down, to preach, to teach, and to believe. Help us proclaim the gospel with the favor of your greatest deacons and believers. Make our lives molds of Christ the servant, that we may love others as he did, and always see him in those we meet, even the poor, the sick, the lonely, or the lost. Let your words be our words, and let our actions be your actions. Make our hands your hands, outstretched to carry on and comfort and bless. Grant us the grace to be worthy of the work we are beginning, so that we may one day worship you in your sanctuary, serving in eternal joy at your table. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You want me to take the chair? I know that's important. If it was, some of the rest of these guys would be cute, and they're not. But, and we will be doing more of this by about in September. There are several men that we as deacons are looking at to ordain to be more part of our group. And so we'll be doing this again soon. You know, you get off stuff during COVID. COVID's over, and we're going to press ahead. So look forward to that.
Okay, we'll move from that right to pain and suffering. Everyone endures pain and suffering at some point in their lives, and everyone to a different degree. None of us want to go through it, and when we do, we try to pray our way out. Well, some pain we may never escape in this fallen world. But pain is not meant to make us weaker, but to strengthen us. And you may wonder, where is God in my suffering? Well, rest assured, he is with you. Our suffering is not meaningless, but because of God, there is meaning and purpose in our difficulties. Our victory comes through faith in Jesus. And even if you don't feel victorious today, just know that for the believer, suffering does not end in defeat, but victory. So let us remember, as it says in Ecclesiastes, to everything there is a season and a time, to every purpose under heaven. Maybe you are in a time of suffering today. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. I want to leave you with a quote from a Southern Baptist pastor. He says, "Your greatest ministry will most likely come out of your greatest hurt." Just something to ponder. So let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you that we have the privilege of gathering this morning in your name to worship you. We realize that there may be some here with a heavy heart today, going through a time of suffering. And we pray that today you would be, that everyone who is suffering would find comfort by your spirit and be encouraged by your words. You are greater than anything we will ever face. And as long as we are in Jesus, we will be victorious. Help us to trust you fully in our difficult times. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. One of the best things that I have done since I've been at Hebron you were visiting several times, and you told me you came because you wanted to worship with your mom, Mary. And so you came, you guys came a few times. You came right up here to the stage afterwards, after a service, and you said a compliment about our band. And I said, so when are you going to join? And I joined very soon after that. I did a good thing, didn't
I? You did, you did. All right, let's all stand as we begin to worship.
So you know what they say about pain and suffering. Just a few more weary days, and then so that Reggie can sing out real loud above all of you, because this is a song he suggested. He knows a little bit about heartache and hurt and pain, and he also, his testimony is that through it all, Jesus is stronger, Jesus is better. And so we're praying for you, Reggie, as you get ready for a heart surgery, and thank you for this suggestion for all of us to sing.
Tears and sorrows, I've had questions for tomorrow. There's been times I didn't know right from wrong, but in every situation God gave me trusted consolation that my trials come to more than makes me strong.
Sing how you know it.
I've learned to trust in God through
him for the valleys. I thank him for the storms he's brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. I'd never know what faith in God could do.
Sing, church.
Through it all, trust in Jesus, I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word.
One more time.
Show me now the end.
Wow, that's good. Thank you, guys. Welcome Will back. He's filling in for Jonah. But that was awesome, guys. Thank you. It's always good to worship, and it's always good when the worship is great. Because all I need to do is get up here and not blow it from this point on. But my subject matter is something that every one of you, in a different way, is an expert on. Because none of you have escaped pain and sorrow and suffering. Not a one of you. Remember when you were young and you got growing pains? Matter of fact, there was a program that was on, very popular program, and it was called Growing Pains. And it was really about these little kids, and I'm happy to say I never saw it, never watched it, because I thought it was silly. But it was very popular. As a matter of fact, they've done a retro Growing Pains thing. And it was all about this confused little family. Well, I remember growing pains that were physical. I remember when I was young experiencing these pains because my body was growing. And I felt like it was unpleasant, unwelcome, unappreciated. And just reminders that our bodies are growing and bringing about necessary changes that have to happen. When your muscles begin to expand and you begin to grow so fast that your back hurts and your legs hurt and you go to bed aching, and you know, some children experience it so devastatingly that they weep as they try to go to sleep. And then you think, you know, if I could just get to my teens and all this mess would quit. And then you get to your teens and you have all kinds of different kinds of sufferings and sorrows. Your brain goes crazy. Chemicals that weren't working in your mind kick in. You know, dopamine, you know, it begins to kick in, and you begin to think like a teenager. You know, your mother, who was once mom, is now mother. You know, and your sentences consist of whatever. I didn't think my kids would ever quit saying that. You'd be having a conversation with them, and you'd end the sentence, and they'd go, yeah, whatever. Amen. Which meant, aren't you an idiot? Right? And so there's suffering that goes on when you're a teen, so you think, surely when I get to be a young adult, I'll jump in there, and the suffering will end, the pain will end. And some people, they have physical pain during that time. They may have some disease. But even if they don't have a disease, the mental part of being a young person, being a young adult, is very difficult. And they make it difficult on everybody around them. Right? You ever heard the word millennial? It's a different generation. And they think differently, and they have their own package, their own pain. Every generation has their own package and their own pain. I'm from a crazy generation, and most of you are from it too. And we had our own kind of pain. We had our own way of trying to soothe it or put salve on it. We tried so many different things. So it's essential for us to also know that pain is a part of our spiritual and emotional growth. So it happens at every stage. And then, of course, when you get to be a full-blown adult, you know, if it doesn't hurt, it's probably not working anymore. Right? Last week, God gave me a toothache, you know, because nobody was going to be working in the dentist office from Friday through Tuesday. So that's when I decided I'd get this massive toothache. And you just, you know, you get our age and you just want it, somebody take it out, make it go away. And so I got it worked on Tuesday, and the work made it hurt worse for a couple more days. And so you're living with pain, and you're living from minute to minute. And other people have differing kinds of pain. It just hurts. I have a dear friend that I had lunch with, me and another friend of his, and he's suffering with a lifelong disease that is taking his body down, dragging him down. And this big, tall, handsome guy, now given to a wheelchair. And as we're having lunch, I watched him tear up because we were challenging him on, don't quit. You know, do the rehab. Make sure you stay strong. So even in that chair, you're able to move. And big tears. I just want out. I just want to be done. That's what pain will do to you. It reduces us to wanting to give up. And pain comes from everywhere. I mean, it comes from families. It comes from relationships. It even comes from marriage. Did you know that? There's a pain package within marriage. You know what I ask young couples when I'm doing premarital with them? I say, how many rings are involved in marriage? They look at me kind of funny. They say, well, there's an engagement ring. Then the girl gets a ring. And the guy gets a ring. There's three rings. I said, nope, you missed the most important ring. They said, what's that? Suffering. Suffering. Because right now you don't get it. Right now you're just looking into each other's eyes and there's stuff wrong with that other person, but you're overlooking all of it because you can't wait to get to the finish line and get married. And then you get married and you realize I married a person who is suffering emotionally, maybe physically. And all of a sudden you have suffering within the marriage, within the relationship. And if you haven't bound a friendship together that can get you through the suffering, you won't make it. Matter of fact, the number one reason people divorce is because something, some kind of suffering, some disease, something comes into that family unit, into that marital unit. And one gives up and runs. Many times if there's a challenge with a child, yeah, one just decides, I'm out. I can't take this amount of pain. And so there is that. And so everywhere you look, there's suffering. So let me give you a definition. Localized physical suffering associated with bodily disorders as a disease or an injury. A basic bodily sensation induced by a noxious stimulus received by naked nerve endings characterized by physical discomfort as a pricking or a throbbing or an aching, and typically leads to evasive action on your part. So there's an acute also, to go with it, there is an acute or emotional distress or suffering. Grief. That's the definition. That's the definition. And you wonder about it, and you wonder, why is it like that? And when I think about pain as it relates to Jesus' life, I go back to the Prince of Prophets in Isaiah, one of the finest prophecies related to Jesus in Isaiah 53, verses 3 through 6. It says, he was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with the deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and we looked the other way. And he was despised and he did not care. Yet it was our weakness that he carried. It was our sorrow that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so that we could be whole. He was whipped so that we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray our own way. and we have left God's paths to follow our own. And yet the Lord laid on him the sins, the iniquity of us all. Interesting title. You know, I bet if we started around the room and said, hey, give me a title for Jesus, a lot of you would say, Lord, Savior, Son of God, Son of Man. There are so many different names for Jesus, different names that are descriptive of who he is. And yet, probably no one would bring up Man of Sorrows. That probably would be the one that everybody would miss. And yet, here's Isaiah prophesying about Jesus, and he's saying he's going to be the Man of Sorrows. He's going to be the man that takes the sin of the world upon him. He's going to be rejected. He's going to be beaten. He's going to be all these things that did happen to Jesus, and he is the Man of Sorrows. These are synonyms for pain and physical and emotional sorrows. Jesus would bear it all. There's not any pain, any difficulty, any emotion you go through that the Savior hasn't gone through and doesn't know about. You don't serve a God who can't be touched, but you serve one who, just like you, according to Jeremiah, has been touched with the same kind of sorrow, the same kind of pain, and even worse. Of course, when it's pain and it's yours, you don't care about that, right? When it gets personal, you just kind of want out. Well, Jesus is qualified to be the Savior through his suffering. In Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 through 9, it says, while Jesus was here on earth, he offered up prayers and pleadings with a loud cry and tears to the one who could rescue him from death. And God heard his prayers because of his deep reverence for God. And even though Jesus was God's son, he learned obedience from the things that he suffered. And in this way, God qualified him as the perfect high priest, and he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him, for all those who receive him, for all those who call upon him as Savior. See, Jesus had the correct response to pain. He had the correct response to the sorrow in his life, and it was the crucible in his life, the Man of Sorrow part, that qualified him as our Savior. And when it comes to pain, when it comes to sorrow and suffering, you and I want nothing to do with it. When was the last time you got up and said, well, you know, it'd be really nice to have some kind of real pain today? You know, some debilitating thing that's just going to knock me down and make me feel awful. I think I would enjoy that. Or maybe just some deep emotional sorrow. Maybe some major grief package that I can't even think. No, we don't do that. We do everything that we can to avoid it. We try to avoid it through drinks, through drugs, through relationships. Any way we can get away from pain, we want away from pain. Anything anybody gives us, we will take. There's not a pill on the market I hadn't tried. People say, hey, you tried this? No, but I will. See how it goes. Because I'd do anything to get out of pain. My brother-in-law beat me up while we were on vacation. Hey, I found this new thing. It's all herbs. He said, I think it'll cure your back. And I'm like, uh-huh. And he goes, no. I gave it to this person. They were here for knee surgery. They didn't have knee surgery. And I'm like, uh-huh. I'm a little skeptical. Why? Because I've tried everything. And so have you. When you're in pain, you'll see a commercial. I had somebody give me some of that stuff that comes from marijuana. CBD. CBD, and they gave me a little jar of CBD. Put that on it. Pain will go away. So later they asked me after I'd gone through the bottle, oh, how'd it go? And I said, I don't know. I couldn't keep it lit. I mean, perhaps I was using it wrong, but I mean, you know, just had a little marijuana thing on it. I'm from the 60s, okay? We got rid of our pain a whole nother way. My generation used to count grams of drugs, and now we count grams of food. So, Jesus qualifies based on his pain. Now, Philip Yancey wrote a great book called Where Is God When It Hurts? Listen to what he says. He says, I've never read a poem extolling the virtues of pain, nor seen a statue erected to its honor, or heard a hymn dedicated to it. Christians don't really know how to interpret pain. If you pin them against the wall in a secret moment, many Christians would probably admit that pain was probably God's one mistake. And he should have worked out a little harder and invented a better way of coping with the world's dangers. And we think that because pain is hard, especially emotional pain. It is a test, it's a trial. But I see it as an unfair, unexplainable interruption. And James would say, you need to welcome all suffering. It comes as a friend. Yeah, I've never really thought of suffering as a friend. Have you? I'm serious. When I say I've tried everything when I've been in pain, I even thank God for it. There's a concept. Thank you, Lord, that I'm hurting right now, like beyond what I think I can stand. We don't get it. Suffering is the avenue that leads us to Christ. It is the avenue that strengthens our faith. We just don't know how to use it. And we don't know how to use it because it's so darned unpleasant. This quote from C.S. Lewis became amazingly personal for me this week. Mental pain is less dramatic than physical pain, but it is more common and harder to beat. The frequent attempt to conceal mental pain increases the burden. It is easier to say my tooth is aching than it is to say my heart is broken. If the conflict persists, the effect is devastating. Send me to a dentist when I have a bad tooth, but where do I go with a broken heart? It's a great question. It is intense. It is a trial, but I see it as an interruption. The only thing that pales to the physical pain that we feel in this world is the emotional pain that is upon all of us. And where do you go with a broken heart? Where do you go when mentally and emotionally you're devastated? Who are you going to call? Ghostbusters? Where are you going to go? Who are you even going to mention it to? Who are you going to tell? For the most part, we swallow and wear it. And you know what? It doesn't matter how old you are. Matter of fact, Jesus is 33 years young, 3 years into his ministry, and he will face the worst ordeal headed toward God's will, the worst emotional ordeal any person could ever face, the worst physical pain any individual would ever have, and he would face that. So Daniel, very young, also faced pain and suffering and sorrow. Joseph, sold at a very young age, life of suffering and sorrow, only to be raised up because of the way he handled it in both cases. There is an obedience to Christ that comes when you begin to understand how to focus what it is God's up to in your life and start recognizing it involves pain. By the way, some of our pain is self-inflicted. You know, God didn't inflict my bad knees on me. I did that all on my own. When I played ball, they said, man, leave it all on the field. I did. Every bit of it. Matter of fact, I didn't save any back for now. I did that. But God's been precious in the midst of all of that. So Jesus' ordeal with God's will begins in Matthew 26, verses 36 through 39. And I want to show you what at least for me, even though the cross was devastating, the cross was evil, the cross was more painful than anything a person ever had to go through, for Jesus, it is the garden that created sorrow, that created such emotional pain in his life. Look at what it says. And Jesus went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane. And he said, sit here while I go over there and pray. And he took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, James and John. These are also the two disciples that saw him in the transfiguration, that had seen him in the Shekinah glory of God. And he began to anguish and distress. And he told them, my soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Now, I want you to understand, when Jesus looks at them and says, my spirit, my soul is crushed, I'm broken. I'm broken with grief all the way to death. He's not referring to the cross. Jesus, from eternity past, knew all about the cross. This is not him saying, I'm nervous now because now I have to go through all this pain that I know is coming. Not what he's talking about. Not what he's talking about at all. He's talking about how his soul is crushed and filled with grief because of what he has to do in terms of his relationship with God. And he went on a little further. And he bowed on his face to the ground praying, my Father, if it is possible, let the cup of suffering be taken away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine. You hear what he said? Most people look at that and they say, well, yeah, he's trying to avoid the cross. No, has nothing to do with that. Not a thing to do with that. What it has to do with is for all of eternity, Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit are one. They have never been divided. They have never been separated. And what Jesus knows about salvation and what he knows about the plan is what Isaiah said. Isaiah said, and the iniquity of us all were put on him. He was going to be the only sacrifice that God would allow for your salvation. He was it. There isn't another coming. There wasn't one before. But for it to happen, God had to completely turn his back. And for the first time in all of eternity past and all of eternity future, God and Jesus would be separated. And that's what he's praying won't happen. He's saying, God, if there's any way you can work it out so that I can maintain my oneness, my relationship with you, please work it out that way. But he said, not my will, but your will be done. In Matthew, when he's dying on the cross, one of the things that he says from the cross is, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Very significant. Words are so important in Scripture, and how they're given to us is important. Do you know the only Hebrew in the New Testament is that? That particular verse is the only Hebrew in the New Testament. And so when you read that, you think, that must be significant. That God would preserve the Word of God in such a way that at that moment he would have that said and he would record it in Hebrew. Let me tell you why. Because if you interpret it, it's my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And there's been all kinds of people explain that. That's the hypostatic union of God. Jesus was fully man, and he was fully God, and this was the fully man part screaming out because he felt abandoned. This is all that. No. That's why it was given to us in Hebrew. When you want the emphasis on something, in Hebrew, you just say it twice. What did he say twice? My God, my God. Why hast thou forsaken me means nothing. My God means major significance. Now, Jesus called God, my Father, which is in heaven, about 127 times. 27 times or so, he said, your Father, which is in heaven. One time. One time he refers to him as my God. And the reason is at that moment, God had to completely turn away from Jesus. He had to ignore him. The presence of God went away. The feeling that he had never felt, the emptiness of being without God, being lost, was in Jesus at that moment. It was as though everything spirit-wise had been jerked out of him. Far worse than any other pain that he was now experiencing. But listen to what Jesus does in that moment. He says, my God. And he says that because he knows that even though he can't feel God, he belongs to him. Have you ever hurt, suffered emotionally so much that you began to wonder if you even knew God? Or if God even knew you? Isn't it refreshing to know that the Savior of the world, when he reached that point, he still knew he belonged to God? Still knew it. Still could call it out. He couldn't say, Abba, Father, and bask in the feeling of it. But he theologically, judiciously know, I'm God's son. God still has me. Even though I can't sense it, I can't feel it. Then in verses 40 through 43, it says, then he returned to the disciples and he found them asleep. How many of you fall asleep when you pray? Why do you think that happens? It just happens. It happens because we're weak. It's part of what Jesus said, I'm dying for their weaknesses. And he said to Peter, Peter, couldn't you watch with me for even an hour? They fell asleep within an hour. God had just had dinner with them. He had just explained what's going to happen. This is my body broken for you. This is my blood shed for you. It's going down. They're going to come get me. They're going to take me away. One of you is going to deny me. Matter of fact, he just left the room. So it's not like they didn't know this was a big night. Not like they didn't know that they needed to be standing on the watch. God, what a great lesson for, you know, I mean, Christians have gone asleep. God is wanting us to do some things. God is wanting us to lead out. God is wanting us to be strong and stand by faith. God is wanting us to save our country. And we couldn't even stay awake an hour. We're just like Peter. You know, this sounds hard. You know, I ate and my tummy's full. I just sort of needed a nap. Right? It's like me on Sunday. I mean, I got it on golf, and I'm not watching. I watch all golf matches through my eyelids because I'm gone. I'm just sitting there, and my head's back, my mouth's open. I am out. Donna can come in a room, make all kinds of noise. She can do whatever she wants to do. Long as she doesn't take the remote, I'm not coming around. As soon as she takes the remote, I go, hey, I was watching that. I remember waking up one time watching, she had turned it to HGTV. And I thought, man, this is a long commercial for Home Depot or something. I just went back to sleep. Couldn't deal with it. I petered out. Hey, maybe that's what that means. He says, keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the body is weak. We gave in to temptation. The temptation to not be different than the culture. The temptation to not be the enemies of the culture. The temptation to just kind of go with the flow. If it feels good, do it. If it's right for them, let them have it. No. That's asleep. He says, your spirit's weak. And then Jesus left them a second time and prayed, my Father. Same prayer. If this cup cannot be taken away unless I drink it, your will be done. God answered the prayer. He prayed that God would take the cup so that they wouldn't be divided. And then he went over and he looked at the product of what it is he had to save, who were sound asleep. And he went back in the garden and said, I get it. I got to do this. And when I said, your will be done, I meant it. So I'm good. And when he returned to them, he found them sleeping, for they could not keep their eyes open. And then in verses 44 through 46, it says, so he went back a third time, saying the same thing again. And then he came to his disciples and said, go ahead and sleep. Have your rest. But look, the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up, let's be going. Look, my betrayer is here. Such pain. Matter of fact, in another gospel, the Gospel of Luke, it talks about the ordeal and the amount of pain he was experiencing as he was praying. And it says, he prayed more fervently and he was in such agony of spirit that his sweat fell to the ground like great drops of blood. That's a very rare condition. It's called hemidrosis. And when a person has the condition of hemidrosis, it is a condition in which the capillary blood vessels that feed the sweat glands rupture, crushing them blood comes out. And it occurs under conditions of extreme physical or emotional stress, or both. Now, what I want you to understand, this is a real condition that exists. You are sweating, but your sweat turns into blood because your sweat glands have been burst, and now just your bloodstream is coming out of your skin. By the way, this is a condition that indicates that you're in big physical trouble, and you are probably not going to make it. Most people who suffer from this condition don't suffer very long from this condition because they die. He was in physical pain. He was in deep emotional pain, probably unlike any of us have ever experienced, because he knew what was at stake here. And that was the ordeal. And so what does it mean? You know, life is just a dichotomy. You know, if I were to ask you, hey, how are you? How's it going? What are you going to say? Fine. I'm fine. It's good. All good. We answer that all the time. Hey, how you doing? Fine. It's all good. Not all good. It's not all good. You want to hear the real answer? I'm fine. And I'm completely undone. Now, I'm wonderful. And I'm in absolute despair. I'm full of hope and faith. And I'm depressed and filled with fear. I'm joyful and full of peace. And my spirit is absolutely broken. I'm satisfied and fulfilled. I'm anxious and desperately lonely. That's what really needs to be said when somebody says, "How are you?" All those emotions are there. So some analogies of pain, because we all are in that dichotomy. We're not fine. We're not even supposed to be fine. We're supposed to hurt. We're supposed to hurt physically so that our body is warning us about a problematic issue in our life. We're supposed to hurt emotionally because things count and we have passion. And for the Spirit to come alive in our lives, we're to experience it, whether we want to or not. And as we do, let me just say, relationally, no one stays closer than Jesus. Internally, no one will heal you deeper than Jesus. Physically, no one will comfort you better than Jesus. And truthfully, no one understands the benefit of pain in your life better than Jesus. When you feel physical pain, you need to think, what must it have been like for the Savior? When you experience emotional pain, you can recognize that He understands, He knows. He can comfort the deepest, darkest place with your permission. When you know Jesus, when you have Jesus in your heart as your personal Savior, when you have trusted Him and given your life to Him, that your suffering has meaning. Whether it's physical or emotional, it has great meaning to God. And when you begin to give it to God, it will then have great meaning to you. Sean said it. When you have suffered through something, that may turn out to be the greatest source of the ministry you have on other people. Relationally, no one stays closer than Jesus. Internally, no one heals deeper than Jesus. Physically, no one comforts better than Jesus. And truthfully, no one understands the benefits of pain in your life better than Jesus. Life is difficult, full of pain and sorrow, but our Savior was the man of sorrow. He knows. He cares. Amen. Father, thank you. Thank you that no matter how we try to hide our pain, you know it. And the answer to C.S. Lewis, where do I go with a broken heart? You go to Jesus. You go to the Savior. You go to the only person that can mend the broken heart of an individual. And Father, I know that today I'm talking to people who are broken, wounded, deeply hurt, in depths of physical pain, and even worse emotional pain. And Father, I just pray that they would know that Jesus is the comforter. He is the one who came. He knows. There's not anything about their suffering, their sorrow, their pain that He isn't in touch with. So, Father, I pray that You would enter again into our experience and not heal us from pain and suffering, but guide us. Guide us. Be there with us. Help us to recognize it in its reality, in all of what it is, and help us to obey it so that we can be obedient to You. In Jesus' name, amen. Concentrate on how you really feel. I'm gonna ask you, how are you? How you doing? And I want you to tell me. I want you to tell God. All of it. All of it. God, I hate who I am. I'm selfish. I'm self-centered. Why am I like that? God, I'm quick-tempered. What is that? What is it in my family that destroyed the joy that I'm supposed to have now? Why am I not the Christian that You've called me to be? God, take my pain. As I confess it, take it and use it effectively. Effectively in Your kingdom. Help it, help the pain to be a guidance to You, a pull to You, rather than just an affront and an uncomfortable thing for me. As I give it to You.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard. But to hear what You would say, the word of God speak, would You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see Your majesty, to be still and know that You're in this place. Please let me stay.
My God, my God. Well, thanks for hanging in for pain and suffering and sorrow. It is from Scripture. It is from Jesus, the man of sorrow. So I'm praying that just a little more understanding around it will create a different kind of awareness of it, and that you will enjoy the fullness of the Lord. So come back Wednesday. We're doing apologetics, and we're in the apologetic, the doctrine of anthropology, true anthropology. Actually, anthropology didn't come from science. It came from the Bible, which is not a scientific book, but never scientifically incorrect. Very important for you to understand that and the arguments around it. So we'll be studying that. And Donna, the source of much of my suffering, my wife, and me, a source of her suffering. You know, one of my pet peeves is when preachers talk about their wives and their relationship as though it's like flawless and perfect, and they just got it going on. And most preachers do that. My lovely wife, you know, and they make a big deal. Now, my wife is lovely. And I outpunted my coverage, and I get it. I know all that. But I'm a major source of pain in her life, and she in mine. That's the reality, right? If you're married, say amen.
Amen.
All right. She gets it. She knows it. I'm in pain today because all the stuff I had to do yesterday. I didn't finish my honeydews till 11 o'clock last night.
Because why? Because we got family coming.
We got family coming. And it has to look like in our home as if no one lives there.
But some of them might come next week here.
Yeah. I hope so, all the stuff we've done. I got to sit down. And you tell them what the girls are doing.
In July, do we have that slide? We got a Bible, we don't have it. It's online. I'll be telling you, it's actually right over there. What's my first date? The 11th? 11th? What's the next date, Steve?
I don't know, 7 days after that.
3 Mondays in a row. And 18th. It's going to be awesome. I've never shared my testimony at First Baptist Hebron. So for the women, I'd like to do that. And then after that, Marianne Leach will share hers. And after that, the last week, June Hunt will share hers. And they're all very, very different. And I know you ladies will be blessed. I'll have smaller cards next week, and we'll start spreading the word. I hope you'll bring a friend, because you know you can't argue with a changed life. You can't argue the fact that God saved you. You don't see the wind either, but you see the trees blowing. And so I'd like to share what God did for me as a child until now with you. So it's going to be 3 really great weeks, and I hope we're in the new fellowship building and we can serve dinner. So, yay. That'd be good. All right, you guys have been awesome. You sang so well today. So one more time, we'll sing on our way out, huh? Mm-hmm. Thank you for being here, Will.